Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thanks for attending my defense. First of all, I'd like to thank my advisor, Dr. Amit Sheth, and my committee members, Dr. T.K. Prasad and Dr. Derek Dora. Today, I'll be talking about characters and concepts in taxonomy by entity recommendations.
This way, there is more of you covered and higher.
Following the semantic definition, entities are resources that describe objects in a web of data. For example, if we take Wikipedia, entities are its terminal pages. And for recommendations, we can say that the entities are it can be films, books, or phones. Entity recommendation systems have become popular and an integral feature of our daily activities on the web. For example, if you take e-commerce applications such as Amazon, it recommends products from its huge catalog based on users' interest. And similarly, Netflix recommends films or music, TV series based from its huge collection based on users' what users may be interested in. And this feature has become has been reducing burden on users by navigating them to entities of their interest based on from a huge catalog. And taxonomies have been utilized for entity recommendations. And what I mean by taxonomy is that it's a classification into ordered categories. For example, if you take the three films, we can certainly classify them into science fiction films. And this category can further be categorized into films by genre. Such taxonomies have been utilized by popular applications like Pandora, Netflix, and Amazon. And how taxonomies can be utilized for this purpose? Considering the same example, if a user has rated these two movies on a scale of 5, we can recommend other entities belonging to this category, such as Iron Man. And utilizing taxonomies has multiple advantages. Researchers have shown that taxonomies utilized have solved a cold start problem and data sparsity problems. These two problems arise when there is less interaction from a user on a platform. And utilizing taxonomies as background knowledge can help in solve this problem by adding background knowledge. And taxonomies also have improved recommendations in terms of diversity, diversifying the recommendations and recommending novel entities to the users. However, largely these taxonomies used are manually created, which is a time-intensive process and has limited coverage and lacks timely updates because of the manual creation. And this challenge can be addressed by utilizing the taxonomies derived from crowdsourced knowledge bases. However, the potential of crowdsourced knowledge taxonomies has not been well explored thus far. In the past, recommendation systems which have used knowledge bases as background knowledge for recommendations have completely ignored the taxonomic structures. In this thesis, I have explored the characteristics of concepts in a crowdsourced taxonomy that can impact entity recommendations. Contributions of my work are exploring a taxonomy derived from crowdsourced knowledge base for entity recommendations, and I have defined three characteristics of concepts in a taxonomy that can impact recommendations. And experimented seven measures representing these three characteristics using an adaptation of spreading activation algorithm, and discussed the impact of these measures on entity recommendation systems. And in the further talk, I'll be talking about Wikipedia taxonomy and the three characteristics that I have explored, the entity recommendation algorithm that I have used to study these three characteristics and the measures that I have used, and followed by evaluation with results of their impact, characteristics impact. Wikipedia taxonomy. As we all know, Wikipedia is a crowdsourced encyclopedia, and Wikipedia has a hierarchical category structure which is utilized for categorizing the articles on Wikipedia. And this category structure is created and updated by volunteers. Since it's hierarchical, we can derive a taxonomy, so we can address the challenges in creating a manual taxonomy. For example, if you take film Star Wars, it has these many categories created by the volunteers. And what I mean by hierarchy in these categories is that all of these categories in turn have their parent categories. For example, if you take American science fiction film, action films, it has in turn again American action films, American action fiction films, and so as its parent categories. And this forms as a hierarchical structure. However, since this is a crowdsourced hierarchy, it has cyclic relationships in it. And this actually prevents it from using it as a pure taxonomy. Hence, I have utilized a derived taxonomy from this category structure from our previous work as background knowledge for exploring characteristics of a taxonomy. And going further, I'll be talking about the characteristics of concepts in Wikipedia taxonomy. Based on prior literature and the challenges with utilizing crowdsourced taxonomies, I have particularly focused on three characteristics of categories in taxonomy that can impact entity recommendations. For example, the three characteristics are, the first one is specificity. The specificity characteristic focuses on the abstractness of categories in the taxonomy and how the abstractness or specificity of categories impacts recommendations will be studied using this characteristic. And the second characteristic is domain relatedness. Using this characteristic, we focus on the domain relatedness of a category. What I mean by domain relatedness is that we focus on the relevance of a category, domain relatedness of a category on the when we are recommending something. And the third characteristic is priority. Using this priority characteristic, we focus on the suitability of a category to an entity. First, I will be talking about the specificity and the measures that I have explored for this characteristic. As I mentioned before, specificity measures the notion of abstractness of a category. A category such as science fiction film is very specific than a category film, and we hypothesize that utilizing specificity as a characteristic, we can make better recommendations. And however, measuring specificity of categories in the taxonomy has been challenging. For example, English language films and science fiction films are at the same hierarchical level in this crowdsourced taxonomy, which makes it a challenging to understand which one is specific or which one is abstract. Hence, in order to understand specificity, measure the specificity, I have explored three measures. Three of them are Resnick, Psycho, and out degree based measures. Coming to the first one, Resnick et al. Have proposed a specificity measure for categories in the taxonomy. This measure is based on the probability of a concept's entity occurrence in a corpus. For example, if we take films, a category such as English language films has higher probability of occurrence through its entities in the corpus. And if you take a very specific category, science fiction action films, will institute will have very less probability of occurrence in a corpus of films. Based on this intuition, they proposed a specificity measure for categories in the taxonomy. And when we are looking at the number of entities of a category, they look at all the subsumed categories. What I mean by subsumed here is that if you take American films category, it subsumes all the entities of American thriller films and American action films. And using it as number of entities subsumed by that category will increase the probability. And hence we can understand whether it is abstract or specific category.
If there is cyclic,
that cyclic relationships have been removed. Removed. Yes.
Can you explain exactly? We have the log here. Wouldn't just taking PFC give you the same ranking?
Well,
I guess 1 minus PFC would be the same measure, right?
Is it because of numerical, like underflow or overflow? Is it why you're using log scale maybe?
They have augmented this probability with log scale when it is calculated for specificity.
I guess I mean if you were to rank by PFC, you get the same ranking as if you ranked by log PC, right? Mm-hmm.
But if you have higher number of entities, and the corpus size is higher, the value of probability will be
very... So you actually use the specificity value at some point. It's not just for ranking.
It is not for ranking. And this
is... It's just...
Yes. Coming to the next measure that we have looked at is based on hyponyms, which is proposed by Seiko et al. It looks at hyponyms of a category in the whole taxonomy. What I mean by hyponym is that if you take this node in this diagram, all these nodes of it become hyponyms of this node A. And hyponyms of a very lower level category will have very less number of hyponyms. Based on this, they proposed a measure of specificity for a categories in the taxonomy. The abstract category tends to have higher number of hyponyms compared to a specific category because it has less number of chances to be differentiated further. Based on this, they have used number of hyponyms and total number of nodes in the taxonomy to measure the specificity of the category.
Your problem requires you to understand both the taxonomic relationship but also the number of instances for a node, right?
Yes. Both can help. Mm. We have explored three, we have used three, right? The first one uses entities and this one uses taxonomic relationships. Moving on to the third measure that I have explored, it is based on the odd degree. What I mean by odd degree is that, for example, for a category, the number of immediate children of a category becomes its odd degree. And we have used the higher the odd degree, the more abstract the category is. For example, if we take English language films, it has 30 subcategories and 51,000 films under it. And when we compare it to American science fiction action films, American science fiction, it has only 9 subcategories and 338 films. And you can consider this as an abstract category compared to this very specific category based on its out degree. And we take the inverse of this out degree to measure the specificity of categories in the taxonomy. These are the three measures that I have explored for specificity characteristic and to study the impact of it on the recommendations. Moving on to the second characteristic, it is domain relatedness, and I will be talking about the measures that I have used for this. Domain relatedness looks at the relevance of a category to the target domain. For example, if I am recommending for movie domain, I want to see for an entity there are multiple categories, and I want to see what are the categories which are relevant to domain and how will that impact. And the problem here is the categories of an entity can span across multiple domains. For example, if we look at the categories of Filmsoppy, these are the categories of Filmsoppy. And brain-computer interfacing in fiction is one of its categories, also used for books domain. And similarly, fictional versions of real people is used for TV series domain. And we refer to them as inter-domain categories. And we want to understand eliminating these categories for an entity and using only domain-relevant categories, whether this will help recommendations or not. And I have explored two measures looking for calculating these two measures, this characteristic. The first one is based on shortest path. In this taxonomy, we have multiple domains. And to represent each domain, we can figure out a category which is very abstract and talks about, it can represent a domain. For example, if we take film, which is a very abstract category of film domain, it subsumes most of film domain categories. And we take this as a root node of the domain and see the distance to the domain categories. And what we observed is that the inter-domain categories are at longer distances in the whole category graph compared to the domain-relevant categories. For example, if we take film and fictional versions of real people, these two categories are at nine hops away. And when we look at most of its film domain categories, they can be reachable within six hops. So this, based on this notion, we have calculated domain relatedness of a category and inter-domain and for the inter-domain categories. Moving on to the next measure. We use entities of a category to find out to find the category's relevance to the domain. Fraction of domain-related entities subsumed by a category can be used as a measure for this. We look at the number of entities subsumed by a category. For example, if a category is subsuming 10 entities, we look at the type of each of the entities and see how many of them are relevant to the type domain that we are looking at. For example, if you look at Star Wars, its RDF type is film. And we see how many of the entities subsumed by a category are relevant to the domain. And here the same thing here. When I say entities subsumed by a categories, they also include entities subsumed by its hyponyms. For example, American film subsumes same American action films and American thriller films. We take all the entities subsumed by a category to find out. These are the two measures that I have explored for domain relatedness. Moving on to the next one, the priority measure. This measure was introduced to look at suitability of a category to the entity. Since an entity has multiple parent categories, we want to look at suitability of each category to the entity. And this measure was previously explored by Kapanipati et al. For inferring user interests from fields. And I have explored two measures for this and this as well. The first one is Wikipedia-based measure. It is a Wikipedia volunteer community has been suggested to follow one category ordering rule, where the most significant category should be placed first, and the significance changes from left to right in the decreasing order. And this notion we have explored to find out whether it can impact recommendations or not. And moving on to the second one, this is a similarity-based measure. The more similar an entity to its peers of a category, we hypothesize that the category is more suitable to the entity. For example, if we take the Matrix movie, we build its profile includes all its categories, and we take the profile of parent category and see here the profile of parent category comes from the other entities of this profile of the categories. The other entities, and the higher the, I mean, the other entities categories will become its this category's profile, and the higher the overlap of categories of entity and the category will make it more relevant to the suitable to the entity. And this is the second measure that we have explored for prioritizing finding the suitability of a category to the entity. Moving on, I will be talking about the entity recommendation algorithm that we have used. In order to recommend entities, for example, if a user has rated these three movies, we need to understand the categories that the user may be interested in. For this purpose, previously people have used spreading activation algorithm to generate user profiles for recommendations. Using spreading activation algorithms, an activation function takes the activation of the lower level categories and finds the activation value of this node. And moving further, spreading activation scores the categories in the whole taxonomy. By applying spreading activation, we can find all the activation values, and which will reflect user's interest. And how can we use this activation values to recommend entities? For example, after the activation, we have these activation values. In order to recommend a new movie, we take activation values of its parent and find its ranking in the number of all the entities that the user has never rated. So that we can, based on activation values of the categories, we can rank the entities and recommend them. And moving on to the evaluation.
Good question. So why do you think the activation value represents the most important recommendation? And what is the evaluation?
Categories can be, spreading activation, right? We can customize the spreading activation function, which takes input from its the leaf level nodes, right? And as we go high in the hierarchical level, it will start accumulating the initial activations at one place. I mean, the categories will start accumulating because of their relationships. So, the activation values might reflect user's interest, right? I mean, they are all based on what user has already rated. We are taking user ratings as input for an entity. That's awesome.
I think this makes sense, but so if I've seen 5 action thriller films and I hated them all, I give them all 1 star. And I saw 1 horror film and I gave it 4 stars. I thought it was okay. Uh-huh. Then would the system assume that I like thriller films more than I like horror films?
No.
Because I have 5 1-star ratings, so it's
no.
A 5 activation versus
even
a 4 activation.
Even if it is 5 activation values,
yeah.
You have rated 1 only, right? And when you take the when you activate action thriller films category, you will actually gain very less value. And the horror film that you have rated 5 stars will automatically gain the higher value, right?
I'm just looking at that,
okay.
That equation.
This is the equation for recommending entities. And in this previous...
In that one too, yeah.
We have a I forgot mentioning about the decay factor. Decay factor actually decays the... values from here.
But even then, 5 times D. will always be greater than 4.D,
yes.
Right?
Okay. In that case, we have very less. If we are talking about only about 4 versus 1, we have very less information about the user. And
right.
And this 4, as per the example at least, will not dominate horror films category because we are taking.
Right, but horror films will be activated 4 and thriller will be activated 5. Or 5 times in the past.
Yes, that will come up.
Okay.
But it will not be ranked high.
But it still won't be ranked high.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's keep going now.
So do it average it out in that?
What do you think? Like maybe an average of the rankings or something that's a function of the number of movies I rated. Makes some sense. Let's keep going. Let's not stall here. Let's keep going. What do you think about it?
Okay. Come to the evaluation. In order to evaluate the characteristics performance, we used two data sets which are popular for evaluating recommendation systems. The one is MovieLens data set, which has 1 million ratings and given by 6,000 users, and Books Domain data set from Library Thing, which has approximately 0.25 million ratings. And since we are using DBpedia as background knowledge from Wikipedia, we removed the entities which do not have equivalent DBpedia URI. And in order to avoid data sparsity problems, we have removed users with less than 20 ratings. Coming to the evaluation.
Why is that removing data sparsity problem? You're removing less, I guess, experienced users.
Yes. And since we are recommending entities by ranking, we have adopted a evaluation approach that evaluates top-end performance, actually. And what I mean by top-end is that when we rank entities, we want to evaluate whether the top-end entities are interest to the user or not. And this approach that particularly used with purpose by Kremonosi et al. And in this we take 98% of the ratings as a training set and rest of them as a test entities. And for each five star rated entity from the test set, we select 1,000 entities entities that are not rated by the user.
So why that specific split?
That specific split.
That specific split is because that is what has been recommended in that paper. So they have done that, and that is what they have recommended in the paper. And that has been done by a couple more other places which has utilized the algorithm for evaluation.
So this is as opposed to cross-validation?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's strange, right?
Yeah. See, but is there something magical about the 98.6% number? I mean, is there, like, I guess, what was the rationale for choosing that?
Actually, this evaluation approach was utilized in multiple places, and
So there have been a couple other papers that did the same
yes.
kind of split.
Yeah, this was in 2010 paper and there are papers.
Do you know why? Do you have any, just like intuitively,
why you think this is? Maybe because the data sets that we are using are very large, and I think.
But yours is larger than that, smaller than that. Maybe in that 1.4% makes sense. In your case, maybe 10% makes sense.
No, the same data sets we are using.
So
with 1.4%, you get good enough recommendation entities to be evaluated. So you'll have enough experiments with those 1.4%, and it's not as supposed to cross validation. You can kind of validate that 1.4% randomly 5 times, right? So
Yeah, I mean, to me, that would have been a more realistic way of going. Because 1.4% is kind of dangerous. If for some reason it is weird combination that you're testing, so cross-validation seems to be a more reasonable way.
I think if you actually give them the numbers of how many entities you're actually evaluating with those 1.4%, they'll be more convinced.
Yeah. Okay. If I take only the 5-star rated, I mean, we take this approach takes only the 5-star rated entities, and there are 2,500 odd in the test set. We use 2,500 test set actually from Movil and Scatter set itself. And using the training set and the recommendation algorithm, we rank 1,001 entities, which includes the test entity. And if the test entity is found within the top end positions, we consider it as a hit. Otherwise, it will be a miss and recall villages. Recall will be depending on the number of hits until your particular rank. Moving on to the baseline approach that we have used, in order to understand the impact of each of the characteristics, we start with the basic activation function for the spreading activation recommendation algorithm. And when we look at the performance of this activation function, the recall is at approximately 0.419 for both the data sets. And we adopt this activation function to find the impact of each of the characteristics, right? And to understand the specificity of categories impact on recommendations, we included specificity as a parameter in the spreading activation function, which will and among the three approaches that we have seen, Resnick and Seiko has Seiko has very little impact on recommendations, primarily because of its log-based measure nature. And when we look at OutDegree, it had performed the best for crowdsourced taxonomy because of its higher penalty. For example, if we take English language films, it had 51k films under it. And when we take the inverse of this OutDegree, the penalty for the accumulated activation value is high on this particular, such generic nodes. Hence, when the recommendations are made, these generic categories did not impact recommendations, only specific categories would have been considered. And moving on to the next characteristic that we have looked at, it is priority. We see that the priority had impact on the performance of recommendations. We have seen two measures, one is Wikipedia-based measure and the other one is similarity-based measure. Wikipedia's convention of priority has decreased the recall by 0.07, whereas similarity-based priority improved the performance by 0.25. Because if we look at similar ranking of categories based on Wikipedia and similarity-based measures, we see that the crowdsourced the volunteer community is assigning broader categories and as the foremost important categories for the entity matrix. Whereas our similarity measure has brought specific and relevant categories to the entity matrix. And we concluded that the convention followed by Wikipedia community ignored the semantics of categories when prioritizing them. Moving on to the next one, the domain-related measure. The two measures that we have explored, as you see here, had little or no impact on the recommendations. Because spreading activation algorithm that we have used automatically prioritized in-domain categories. Hence, both the measures utilized did not have any impact. In this work, have explored the crowdsourced taxonomy that alleviates challenges in manually creating a taxonomy for entity recommendations. And characteristics that I have explored are specificity, priority, and domain relatedness. Among the three, specificity and priority had impact on entity recommendations, whereas domain relatedness characteristic has very little or no impact. And in this work, I have devised and explored measures to capture the characteristics of concepts in taxonomy that can help recommendation systems. And for specificity, OutDegree performed thrice as better as existing log-based specificity measures for Wikipedia taxonomy. And for priority, similarity-based measure performed better than Wikipedia convention, which has actually dropped the performance. In future, we plan to work on building a hybrid recommendation system that utilizes these characteristics explored and to compete with the state-of-the-art recommendation systems. And additionally, we will work on understanding the abstractness of user interest categories for each domain in the taxonomy to improve recommendation performance. For example, if we take a user who is expert in cars, we may recommend more specific content in terms of cars than recommend much generic content from other domains, so that we can the recommendations can be made more personalized. Thank you.
Can it be used for reorganizing the categories of Wikipedia page?
Yes.
I had a question on, I think it was about slide 30.
On 3?
3. Yeah, so how do you come up with this value n? How do you choose this rank within the top n? How do you get to that?
Because
you say if that test entity is within rank n, then you say that.
Okay, if I am looking at the performance at a top n, that means top one position, right? I just look at rank top 10. Let's say there are 3,000 movies that the user has never rated. And I want to look at the recommendations of these 3,000. And the algorithm has ranked 3,000 entities. And I look at performance at a top n. That means performance at top one position, performance at top two positions. If I can find the user's test entity within these two positions, I can say that this is the performance at top n positions, right?
So let me pitch in there, right? N is very dependent on your application. If you are putting up a list of 20 items in your recommendation algorithm, Amazon puts up just 5, right? So they are supposed to measure top 5 performance. Netflix puts up 10, right? So they are supposed to measure top 10 performance. Here, in general, recommendation systems go and look at top 20 performance. That is how he has, if you go to the next slide, that's the number he has measured. That's the top 20 performance.
But basically, precision at N and recall at N, first they're doing the kind of evaluation that brings them to how far the precision,
right.
The precise in the beginning for top N or top, for example, 10, top 20. So according to that, they fix the humidity.
But there must be a trade off, right?
Yeah. First, actually, you should try for different n. For instance, from n1 or 2, n, for instance, whatever. Then see that how it changes.
Another question is, do we only measure the hit or we measure the rank of that as well?
We measure the hit.
Yes. What do you mean by we measure the rank?
Rank of, well, if it is within 20, but is it?
Yeah, if you go to the next slide, so that shows the rank, right?
Yeah.
At top 1, what is the performance? And at top 20, what is the performance?
Yeah.
So the rank is actually measured.
Okay, so one of your conclusions was that domain relatedness appears to not have that much of an effect. One of your conclusions was domain relatedness doesn't seem to have a big effect, right?
Yes.
Like no matter what you use, we've got most of the
data. I was hoping for it, but it didn't.
Yeah. Well, is this, so would you conclude that in general, domain relatedness is not that useful? Or is it just because you use spreading activation?
No. Here the problem is we want to eliminate inter-domain categories. Right? We want to see eliminating inter-domain categories help or not. So we used domain relatedness and tried to penalize inter-domain categories. Right? But what happened is the domain relatedness related categories are already favored in terms of the inter-domain relatedness categories related categories are not playing much role in the recommendation
because
no, I think this baseline already captures domain relatedness
exactly.
to some extent.
I think spreading activation already captures
yes.
it, right?
Yeah.
So can you conclude that in the general case domain relatedness doesn't matter? Or maybe it just doesn't matter because you use spreading activation, right?
Maybe because of the baseline that we have missing.
So that's a tricky conclusion to draw then, right? Because it's very
I think can you please go to the domain relatedness slide? So the conclusion is spreading activation algorithm automatically prioritizes in domain categories. So it's very specific the algorithm we are using. So you know to keep it short, I think these two measures which we have tried to use might not have been evaluated properly because of the algorithm. We might have to shift
Agreed.
Multiple algorithms to see whether these two measures make an impact or not.
Yeah, I agree. I think the same can be said for all of your conclusions, right? Because each of these measures were measured very specifically. It's like integrated into spreading activation, right?
Yes.
Okay, I'm just going to ask you a question that I had asked earlier and see if you have any answer. So one of the things that I said was that you're creating a bunch of numeric metrics. And to have faith in what you're doing, I would like to see if it approximates some intuitive idea that we would like to have in the hierarchy. But unfortunately, the Wikipedia hierarchy is flawed and so it doesn't have the kinds of connections that you want. So is this trying to approximate that somehow, some gaps it's trying to fill?
Yes. This whole thing is crowdsourced. There are problems with the relation with the hierarchy that we are using. And for example, if I'm looking at specificity, it is not easy to understand specificity of categories directly. Right? Using hierarchical level, I cannot find out specificity. So we export multiple measures for this. These are the main taxonomy has the problems, and we are trying to find prospective measures to do that.
Yeah, actually what I was expecting to see was, I think I don't remember the exact example, but there were some nodes that were obviously in class-subclass relationship. However, the taxonomy or category hierarchy did not have it. On the other hand, the metrics that you define seems to approximate that, and that may be a way to justify why the approach that you are taking is filling those gaps. So it might be good for you to look at some of those kinds of examples and actually make a case for it.
Sure.
Yeah. Something that's related to what TK said too is, because you're just taking these, like we define these quantitative measures of these three characteristics, and you're just like jamming it into spreading activation, right? You're just like multiplying the result into spreading activation's result, right? So it's very important to understand, I think, what the functional form of these quantitative measures actually look like, right?
Yes.
Like I'm willing to bet the log-based one, bad results, but that's just because no matter what the actual value is, it's a probability, so it's throwing it to something that's really small. And something really small times something, doesn't matter what that something was, right? It's going to be really small, right? So that doesn't probably do anything, right, intuitively. Same, but so for some of these other measures, especially the ones that seem to work out okay, I have a hard time picturing in my head what the functional form of those things look like.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like if the functional form matches our intuition, maybe that speaks a little bit to what TK was getting at. It's like, do these measures actually capture intuitively what we expect or what we want them to? Maybe you can see by looking at just how do these things change with out degree, for example. Because I know degree was a big parameter in most of them, right?
Yes.
Because I think, I mean, that form, that it's exactly the form that's affecting what these curves are looking like, right?
Yes.
Or at least the comparison of that curve to the base activation one. So I think you should do that, actually. Because I think if you do that, too, you could, then you can say something a little bit more general. Because you won't be able, you don't have to tie it to these specific examples then, right?
Yes. I have actually looked at some measures to understand what is happening.
Uh-huh.
And due to time constraints, I did not want to explain details of that.
Ah, you're saying we have these figures, huh?
We have this. I have those results, actually.
We should look at them.
I need to understand. I have that slide.
You can open your paper and show it to them.
No. Wait, I have a
slide.
No, I have a hidden slide here.
You think you limited the presentation of the paper, right?
No. He has explored a lot of other evaluation metrics.
This one was limited to the paper.
No,
in the paper he has way more. This was limited to the difference.
Okay. Well, we don't have to look here, but maybe in summary, take like using these figures in order to support your argument for why you use these metrics. That might answer kind of my concerns, and it maybe relates to what TK is talking about too. Like, is the way we're defining specificity, is it natural or is it intuitive to us? Well, you can take a look at it's how it changes with I or whatever the parameter is to see.
Yeah. Our degree, right? If we look at our degree, subcategories of based on our degree. These are the top 50 categories that we after spreading activation result, right? There are two phases. One is spreading activation, the other one is recommending entity. And when we look at the out degree of the based on top 50 categories, these are the properties. One is mean subcategories based on out degree and the mean entity based out degree. And out degree based measure is able to get all the categories which are specific, which have very less number of entities to them. If you look at entity-based degree, they are very less.
I see. So these figures are kind of explaining what's happening.
What's happening?
I'm not sure that they explain to us what it's.
Function.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah. Like, how? What is its effect on the activation function? You know, here's its effect on the results, or here are the results as a function of these things, right? Mm-hmm. How does it actually affect the way we're activating nodes? Maybe we can talk more in the committee, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't want to harp on this too much. I mean, I do, but not if there are more questions.